Hello, and welcome to episode 331 of the Crate and Crowbar PC Gaming Podcast, recorded on the 9th of July, 2020. I'm Marsh Davis, and I'm joined this evening by Alex Wiltshire.
Hello.
And Rich McCormick.
Hello again.
Hello.
Again.
There's been almost no worthwhile news this week. I mean, Valorant has detailed the costing of some of its skins. Would you like to hear about that?
Yes, please. What's going on with the skins?
Well, they're selling skins in a bundle, four skins, for a mere £100 for you to buy.
How many skins was that again?
Four.
Of the skins?
Four skins, 100 quid. Although it's actually $100 if you buy it in American money, because the tiering of the amounts of Valorant points that you need to buy is such that you can only get the enough points to purchase the skin bundle if you buy at £100.
What are these skins? Are they extraordinary?
They turn your guns into dragons, apparently. So there you go. That's the video game news this week.
And it all started with horse armor. How far we've come.
Yeah. Actually, there was another thing, which is almost interesting. Did either of you see the Assassin's Creed Valhalla leaked video?
No. I saw that it leaked. I did actually notice there's another one got leaked.
Does it actually have any footage in it? I mean, they had the thing with the Xbox announced when they were saying it's going to be gameplay footage, and then it was just all cutscene.
Yeah, no, this is gameplay footage. I mean, apparently it's about half an hour. Well, at least one of the leaks is about half an hour, and the new one is 7 minutes of a boss battle with a demon goddess, apparently. Which is, and the reason I wanted to talk about it, I haven't actually watched it, but I have to say I'm a tiny bit disappointed. Like,
That is your natural state, Martin. Like,
no, indeed. But, like, I'm always disappointed when people are enthusiastic superficially about something that I'm really enthusiastic about. And then I look closer at their enthusiasm, and it turns out they're enthusiastic for a completely different reason for something I find. So, I mean, it's the whole thing about Assassin's Creed is this, you know, this look back at exciting periods of history. And then just to put a demon goddess in the middle of that, right, is just, it's a bit of a, I don't know. I just don't find that exciting. In the same way that the best parts of Game of Thrones are the parts where all the magic is peripheral to what is the human drama, the human politicking. And as soon as magic and dragons and stuff comes to the fore in those books, they become kind of rubbish, really.
What you have to remember, though, is that history is written by the winners. So maybe demons were around then.
See, well, 2020 has certainly proven their ultimate victory over the rest of humankind. So,
I mean, Assassin's Creed is not exact. I mean, there's some history bits, right? But there's not exactly that history. Like, you do, I mean, famously, you end up beating the shit out of the Pope and chasing an apple of. I mean, the whole thing's pretty. I don't know. The demon goddess isn't a particularly big heel turn in my mind for the series. It seems like it was always kind of demon goddesses behind the scenes.
Yeah, I know. I know. I shouldn't be surprised in the way that I am, but still, I don't know. There's just particularly that era is a thing I'm really excited about and interested in. And it seems whenever these sort of things get announced, I'm just like, oh gosh, and I immediately start, you know, writing my own sort of headcanon about the amazing historical dramas that they could unpick or get entangled in. And then they just ignore all that stuff, and it's all about, you know, being able to dual wield and demon gods. And,
well, they always end up just taking all the historical figures from the time, putting them all in the same town, and making them all give you quests for fun, like Benjamin Franklin making you like drive a tank.
Yeah,
that it started with oranges, didn't it? Because that was the one that there was an add-on for it which had you battling Egyptian gods and whatnot, and then that was expanded in which was, I don't know what, Odyssey, yes, oranges and Odyssey, yeah, where you're kind of properly up against mythological stuff. Yeah, I agree, because I would definitely be much more up for beating up people called Athelbold and Athelstan,
yeah,
Athelbert, Athelred.
Yeah,
Alfred, all the apples.
They've got it coming, those Aethels.
What a bunch of idiots. That would be good. I would like that.
How'd you like them Aethels?
But as a...
there you go.
That is good. As a statuesque, wonderful, you know, sort of example of physique, of this kind of blonde Viking, it would be a bit disappointing to kind of beat up these stunted English people, because they'd all be just diseased and kind of withered. It'd just be, you know, what kind of a foe would that be?
The other thing that it just seems, it's fairly, well, I guess you can draw a through line between that and God of War, like God of War being the, let's do Norse, let's do all the Norse gods, and then sharing the same development time, and then being, we're doing Norse, we could do all the Norse gods as well.
Yeah.
Where'd you go from here, though? How'd you go up? Because, you know, like, you're right, because the Assassin's Creed series has escalated enormously. Where do you go from mythological demon gods?
Maybe I should go back down again.
Yeah, that's what they'll do. They'll just go incredibly mundane, yeah, where you're kind of stuck World in War some II. Muddy village. Yeah.
Actually, if that's World War II, it'd be quite weird.
Hull in 1975.
That'd be
that's
so
what
good.
I want.
Yeah, yeah, during some sort of rubbish strike, you know. No, it's getting collected. Yeah. You've got to sort out the you'll be on the side of the strikers, wouldn't you? The kind of the rubbish.
Or you'd be trying to kill them as well. You'd have Philip Larkin and Arthur Scargill as your quest giver.
Yes.
Oh my god. I hope the members of the team who haven't left in disgrace listening to this.
Wow. What have you been playing this week, Rich?
I've been delving back in the mist of time, and I've been playing Red Alert, the remastered, reconstituted.
Oh, yeah.
Did you play it the first time round?
Yeah, so I played me and my... It's a nice heartwarming story. Me and my dad used to play a lot of it, and then it got less heartwarming because he was like, right, well, I'm playing it now because I like it more than you do. And he would take the computer over and play it a lot, and you just hear the dulcet tones of monster tanks, mammoth tanks, sorry, just shooting people for hours on end. But it's one of those games where, you know, when you're a kid and you, well, I guess I was kind of mid-kid at that stage, but when you're that old and you think, oh my God, this is so hard, I'll never beat this, this is impossible. And obviously pre my easy access to game facts or anything like that, not understanding how these missions were completable. And finally doing it eventually. I did complete it when I was younger. But I remember it being pretty hard and very unforgiving. And I was like, oh, I must have been a stupid child, not really understanding how games worked, armed with all this knowledge I have now. And I'm still stuck on Mission 12 of the Soviet campaign. It's fucking nightmarishly difficult. Like,
how far is that through?
From recollection, I think this, I say recollection, I've also been Googling it because I failed it genuinely about 9 times at this point. Like, I think there's 15 missions per campaign, and it's a Soviet campaign. It's always more fun because you do get the mammoth tank. And you have to do this thing where you have to conquer one base on land and then conquer an island base. And the island base is kind of really well defended. And there's 5 tech labs on enemy tech labs on one on the mainland and one on the island, 4 on the island. And then you got to get into the chronosphere and capture the chronosphere in the middle. The chronosphere is like surrounded by AA guns and turrets and pillboxes and walls. So, yeah, genuinely now I must be upwards of probably 10 hours of wasted time on this one mission, because the first time I did it, I ended up accidentally shooting. I built a cruiser after capturing one of the Allied seaport. Like boatyard things, and it immediately shot the chronosphere and the whole thing exploded. So I had to reload that after an hour and a half of playtime. Then the next like 3 times, my tanks that I'd rolled over the island like tickled one of the tech centers and that blew up immediately. So I had to restart the whole thing again. And then the last time I was like, right, I've done it. I've got 3 engineers into the tech centers, got it more sorted, ready to go. I can now attack the chronosphere, and then didn't realize until that point that there's like a trip wire. If you get anything, including the engineer that's going towards it, over the strip wire, the chronosphere will self-destruct ahead of time. So I lost time again there. And it was, I don't know whether it's frustrating because I have the memory of it being frustrating when I was like 12 or 13, or if it's just genuinely very frustrating still now. but it was very, very frustrating.
It sounds awful. is that your sort of are these hallmarks of a sort of the yesteryear of gaming that have since been surpassed by other RTSs?
So it's interesting because, like, if you think, I was thinking about this afterwards. I was like, in terms of RTS campaigns, there's a couple of tentpoles, but there's not really that many since then that have been, okay, here's my RTS campaign that is like thoughtful in terms of design, or even just like has any real kind of, you know, particular main mission design. There's a lot of, you know, sandboxes, your Supreme Commanders and that kind of thing. And great skirmish games are really good fun for that. And obviously a lot of online games as well. StarCraft, I guess. Mm-hmm. You know, StarCraft games obviously had, the three of them had, StarCraft 2, the three of them had excellently kind of paced campaigns, Warcraft 3 as well, but I am whinging a lot about this one mission, but it is a very neat, still it's quite a neat, like, here is your set of resources, here is what you need to do, you've got to combine the two to get a possible outcome, and there's quite a big variance in what you can do as well. Like in previous missions, I failed one of them once just by being beaten, and then completely went the other way and went much more for air superiority instead, and then won that one. And I was like, okay, well, that, here's all that choice that I like in games. You get, yeah, here's your resources, how do you want to spend them? Because I remember playing a lot of, you know, at 12 and 13, playing a lot of skirmish mode where you just can basically just have infinite money to a certain extent and just end up rolling the enemy over with the tank rush, or even not the tank, the opposite of the tank rush, where you just build a shitload of tanks over like two grinding hours, and then just when you feel like your blob is big enough that it can't quite fit on the screen, you roll it all over into the enemy base and just cackle. But this is kind of the neat way of doing it, and it's interesting because it feels quite modern in some ways, in that you have a problem and you have a solution, you need to try and make the two fit. But it also feels very, there's been a lot of player comfortableness making, that's not the right word,
I know what you mean,
over the like 10 15 years 20 years since, like, people are less willing to let the player just, you know, as I have done, waste 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 hour and a half long games in a row on a minor technicality. So I don't know, it's also really tricky to tell because I am heavily nostalgic for this game. It was like one of the very first games we bought our family computer. We got one very late. We bought it from Tiny, I think, the old PC shop.
Mm.
And we came back with a big box version of Red Alert and Tomb Raider. And then I wasn't allowed to play either of them for like a year, because when you put the disc in, it said installing DirectX. And the one thing that my parents remembered the computer salesperson saying to them was, just bear in mind, don't ever install any DirectX on this computer. So
why?
I don't know. I still don't know. I waited until my dad went out and installed it when he was out, after like a year of feeling like, you know, it was going to blow up the family computer. And then finally ended up playing Red Alert, and that's when he got more into it than I did.
I had a copy on my... I bought myself... So I just left university when it came out, and with money from my first job, I bought myself a laptop, and this was the game that I bought on it that actually ran. And it was the first game I also played a PC online game on, and I thought that I was fairly good at it because I played single player, and, you know, God knows whether I really was or not, but I thought I would do okay. And in my first and only match in that game, because I think, I don't know, it must have been some sort of, did you ever play online back in the day, this game, Rich?
I didn't know. I think it was too daunting at that time, trying to, like, you had to find, I guess they didn't really have, well, maybe they did, I don't know if they did server browser at that time, or whether it was just a,
he was in the game connection. Yeah, I don't really remember, he was just in the game, but it was it played within this tiny little window, presumably because it just couldn't run any faster. Might have been my computer, might have been the way it was set up. Anyway, the view of the map was just minute, and the other player, I thought I was building up my base, and it was all good, going well. And the other player did just some, you know, smart strat on me, ended up attacking me from the rear. I was completely destroyed. I had no idea how I could have avoided it. Didn't know anything. Couldn't see anything because of this tiny window. And never went back.
Maybe they were hacking you. That's how you got a tiny window. It wasn't actually meant to be like that.
Maybe it was. Anyway, I've taken the same attitude to all of my online play on all games. If I don't win in the first game, that's it. Over.
It's interesting to see because like I played a lot of StarCraft, and you know, when that came out, like 2010, 2011 kind of time, playing a lot of that online and kind of thinking, you know, my RTS experience of Red Alert was the first one I'd really properly played and got into. And it wasn't much more of that kind of, you know, don't attack me, I'm building my base. I want my base to look perfect and neat, and I want to build all the walls around everything. And the enemies come and blow up the walls, and that's ruining my fun. I want to build 30 tanks, and then maybe I'll do 10 more, and then 10 more, and 10 more. And then you build what you want. It's like it's a bit like kind of playing like SimCity rather than playing like an RTS. And then, yeah, playing StarCraft and things like that, where you are very quickly turning the resources into material, and it ends up being a very transactional and efficient game of what can I get in this time for my money? And, you know, see the micro and the macro kind of side of that. And I was like, wow, this never really happened in older RTS games. And then I realized now playing Red Alert, it very much does. You can, you know, you can build a little force that will do quite well. It's a bit more attritional. You know, a lot of heavy tanks generally does the job just as well as a very neatly constructed force. But it does have that kind of, like, there's a lot of interlocking parts. I could only, before playing this, couldn't remember the full suite of things you can make. Now I can actually see the purpose in them, like mine layers, V2 rockets being super useful and that kind of thing. So there was this, you know, I was just probably too young to kind of really grok it at the time. There was this kind of interlocking layer. The other thing that has absolutely stuck in my brain, I was talking about this with a friend the other day, but there's certain barks and sound effects you get in games that have just burrow your way in. It doesn't matter how many years have passed since the last time you heard them, you can still like recite them automatically. Red Alert is absolutely rammed full of that for me. It's the engineering affirmative. I still walk around the house saying that to myself, and I did before I played the remaster.
It's how you move from room to room.
Yeah, my wife hates it.
How did the cutscenes across these days? This is the one with Tim Curry, isn't it?
I think that was in Red Alert. Come on, Red Alert 4, Red Alert 3. This is, okay. It does have, it's got, I can't remember her name, Natalia, the Stalin and his kind of aide/assistant/rapidly promoted love interest as well. And I remember watching those cutscenes as a kid and being like, oh, this is a bit saucy. But then they kind of, you know what you're getting really in it? It's so, there's got this whole mythos about the FMV in the game that you kind of are expecting to be schlocky. But it's not as like over the top, obviously, as the Command & Conquers with Kane and Nod and all that. But it's still very silly still, after all these years.
How does it look? Because I assume they've done some sort of interpolation on what would be heavily pixelated graphics to make them embiggened for modern resolutions. But does that look as often these things do, slightly melted and shit? Or
so again, this is, it's kind of a bit reductionist because it's just nostalgia speaking for a lot of this. But you go into it and you're playing on the updated graphics, and I was like, oh, this looks like it used to look. You can press spacebar at any time, and it switches back to the old graphics. And when you do that, you're like, oh God, that's how it looked. But I was, you know, I was seeing it the other way, I guess, from the time. It looks neat. It looks fine. They all look, all the things look slightly weird like they used to. They always had slightly weird profiles that didn't quite look, they'd have something distinctive about them. But it didn't look like what they were. Like the light tanks didn't look like tanks, really. They looked like little kind of bumper cars. And the heavy tanks always had two like black spots on top that looked like eyes as well, so they were kind of cute.
So they haven't redrawn anything, right? They are using the original sprites, but they aren't, have been through some processing to make them bigger.
I guess so. Yeah, I mean, I don't, presumably that's how you can flip back and forth between the two. I genuinely don't know about that one, but like they do look mightily similar, so I wouldn't be surprised if you basically just smooth them off a bit. Like it's much more pixely in the original mode. And it looks smoother, but it's still very much obviously true to its original source. It's not, it's a remaster rather than kind of a reimagining. I do really like the ability to kind of flip back and forth. I mean, and I know a set of games have done this. The remastered version of Monkey Island did it as well, didn't it? Where you could kind of hop back and forth between the original graphics and this one. I mean, it's a fun curio, but I don't think I'll ever use it after the first few times of going, oh, that's really nice. That's really fun.
Mm-hmm.
It's funny also because obviously the pixel graphics were initially designed, I mean, not to look, they're very rarely resed down from some sort of perfect version. So like that, actually Red Alert probably was a model that was then kind of resed down, wasn't it? I can't remember how they made these ones.
I think they're probably 3D renders, aren't they, that have been turned into 2D sprites.
Yeah, maybe.
There's a lot of kind of direct stuff in the cutscenes. So they have obviously the very kind of tongue-in-cheeky like character cutscenes that were done like movies. And then you've also got these interstitial bits where you see submarines or planes shooting at tanks on the ground and stuff like that. And they were using 3D renders, and they do look very similar to what you actually get in the game. And a lot of them are actually the unit. And this was in the same the olden days as well, but they're the unit like cards that you click on to buy stuff. So yeah, I wouldn't be surprised if they have just been ported over from that and used in the cutscenes and then ported over to actually pixel art as well. Because there are some weird, even more at the time, there were some weird decisions in terms of, you know, silhouettes and stuff. They became very obvious what they were, but they don't look like the thing they are.
What's the what's the end goal of this project? Are they going to redo the remaining Red Alerts and re-release them?
I hope so. I mean, Red Alert 2 was, again, I've probably got rose tinted glasses. That feels a lot like further along. Feels maybe like it doesn't need a remaster, but I'm sure if I actually played it now, it would be heavily needing a remaster. But that, you know, that was the kind of, I realized as well that I'd crossed some wires in my head, and the first Red Alert was this strange mixture of quite pie-faced in terms of the military side and the difficulty and completing the missions and the silliness of the cutscenes.
But yeah,
the Red Alert 2, absolutely.
That series does give itself over to complete nonsense later on, right? I mean, I mean in a good way.
The psychic dolphins, yeah, in the Red Alert 2 or 3, and then in 3, Yuri's Revenge, when you get like the schoolgirl robot at one point as well, or is that 4?
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
There's parachuting bears at a certain point as well.
I mean,
good innovations.
That was too far. It went too far.
It did. It definitely gets sillier. And you felt, I don't know, I mean, it felt like at the time that Command & Conquer was their excuse to go a bit sillier with the post-apocalyptic stuff. And Red Alert was there. We're going to hew closer to reality. But by the same token, like, I'd say, like the whole idea of we've got Einstein, he's going to go back in history and kill Hitler, and then instead of Hitler, Stalin becomes the new big bad, or at least from the Allied perspective, is I guess still pretty wacky sci-fi stuff as well. It wasn't exactly like, you know, military war games or anything.
Are you in it for the long haul then? Are you going to power your way through this one incredibly obstinate mission?
Oh yeah, the way I play games is absolutely that. Like if it's thumb this nose at me, there's no way that I'm going to let this thing lie at all. Like, I've got to beat it. I know. Like, this is the thing. It's not a question of me going in and being like, oh, "What do I do? What do I do?" It's just a question of don't click on the wrong ship at the wrong time, you idiot. I've done this so many times now. I'm like, I just, because, you know, by an hour and a half in, after attempting it for the third time that week, I'm just like, "Oh, for God's sake, be over now, please." But it's just pressing the wrong things at the wrong time. There are some other fun missions actually as well in it, like. Surprisingly, they stuck with me in a very long career of playing RTS things. Like the one where you're inside the reactor and you get given a small group of engineers and soldiers to try and clear things out. And that's, you know, the very distilled thing of like, here's your resources, here's the enemy, do what you will with them kind of thing. And there is a slightly more structured approach to that in order to do things properly. But I remember playing that as a kid and being like, oh, wow, this is really exciting. And it's still quite exciting now. Like, it's still got that innovativeness that a lot of RTS things don't, where, you know, a lot of RTS campaigns historically have just been, okay, well, we'll put you in a thing, build a base, go and do the thing you've done in every other mission so far, maybe with one new unit this time.
I can't think of that many RTS games which have really sort of bespoke, incredibly structured missions which are easily differentiated from each other in a kind of dramatic way.
StarCraft ones are.
Yeah, there's a few that I kind of stick with, but they, you know, they tend to be older, or they tend to be things. I remember like Company Heroes with the, is it the Cairn, Bridge Owen Cairn one?
Hmm.
And they, you know, reading about that, they, it's a brilliant mission. And it really is like a multi-stage thing, and it sticks with you. But they absolutely like killed themselves to do that. Like that was the tentpole mission again. And it was just like a lot of the rest of it was kind of, didn't suffer from it necessarily, but that was the mission that they really spent ages on. So it turns out the answer to how to make an RTS mission really good is the same as it is in other games, where you just design the shit out of it for ages and polish it and polish it and polish it until it's really good. Whereas, you know, in RTS is arguably a lot of people kind of, A, you don't have the time to do that with the development cycle, and B, a lot of people are going to be playing either online or the skirmish modes anyway. So they really,
I think there's a tension, isn't there? Because, you know, that was the central criticism of the, like, the Red Alert and even the StarCraft approach, which was there was this total difference between the online and skirmish modes and the campaigns, because the campaigns ended up relying on gimmicks that you'd never get to play anywhere else. Like, you know, they'd introduce units that you never ever see in any other mode, or situations that just don't match up, all to create a dramatic feel, which the systems didn't really support in and of themselves. Like, I don't know, that memorability of those missions, you know, and I really enjoyed the StarCraft missions, actually. I've thought the StarCraft 2 missions anyway, and you know, I enjoyed those campaigns, but I also see that by not situating them totally systemically, you're making a bit of a wobbly tower of a game where, you know, a lot of the enjoyment doesn't quite exist in the way that you might want it to in the rest of the game.
Yeah, you've got the trickiness of, and StarCraft is a good example of that, where, you know, the multiplayer is the big part, realistically, of it. But the single player is really good, because obviously Blizzard have such resources in order to do that. But they start off kind of teaching you what the multiplayer is through the single player. But then through things like, you know, you keep branching paths for every unit, and you can kind of make them good at something or good at another thing. And sometimes those, the roaches, you can, I think you get the choice between like burrowing or...
Yeah, they're completely different. And you're going to think, I'm really good with roaches. Like, I'm going to go for a roaches build in my first online game. And then like, oh, these aren't anything like what I'm used to.
These aren't my roaches, yeah. It's definitely that kind of thing. It's tricky to do because, they do have a limit to them. Like, you're only going to play StarCraft campaign probably once, maybe a few more times if you're really into it. But you're going to, most of the resources have to go on the multiplayer side, because that's what is going to keep people coming back. And there's a few, Company Heroes 2 had some okay missions, but it didn't have anything like the Cairn thing. And I guess this was probably the dichotomy between Dawn of War 1 and Dawn of War 2 as well. Like Dawn of War 1 being, I mean, I loved the Dark Crusade, the Necron campaign, where you were basically just a total sandbox thing, where here's a planetary system, get a foothold in each area, defend it, and then try and conquer the whole thing. And that was just, you know, you had a base on each corner of the level, and you had to either defend it or cede it or choose not to defend it. But it was complete sandbox, or it was just a set of skirmish missions. And when Dawn of War 2 was very much more, here's a roller coaster we're making.
Here's your story time. Yeah.
Yeah. And they're both, you know, viable in different ways. I preferred the first because I like base building stuff, but the two had its charm, obviously, big charms as well.
Are you going to jump in on the remastered Red Alert online? See if they've got... I mean, don't know if it even supports it. Does it?
I haven't tried it yet. So there's your answer on that one. I don't... It's not been that kind of game for me so much. It's very much more of a comfort game. I also had to stop playing StarCraft because I got the same problem I have with Dota, where it's just like, if you lose, you feel sad. If you win, you feel like you need to win again. And that's it. There's never any kind of... nice dopamine hit anymore. So when I realized that, I was like, right, I'm gonna put these down now. I'm not playing any more StarCraft anymore.
Yeah, it is interesting that designing for two incredibly different solutions, when you need to make this robust sandbox game that is a preparation for the completely free-for-all multiplayer, but at the same time make a memorable single player campaign. I don't really know how you mesh those two things together.
I guess the answer seems to be just shitloads of money, because the only people that really try and do it, you know, the Call of Duties of the world people like that, where it, if you have essentially the time and the resources to have two development teams, one working on the single player thing and one working on the multiplayer thing. But you've got Blizzard who did it, and then like Activision did it with Call of Duty as well. But they can afford to just park two different teams on it. Trying to juggle both at the same time would be a nightmare in terms of balancing and just actually spending time with stuff as well. You need to have hundreds of playtesters.
Yeah, weirdly, I think, I mean, I don't know if you guys agree with this, but I think it's probably an easier solve for first-person shooters than it is for something like an RTS, where the allure of the RTS is in this sort of self-driven building, which should, if it's rewarding and good, offer you sort of multiple ways to do things. And to sort of limit that in single-player and still make it rewarding seems harder than it would be in a first-person shooter, to take the same sort of weapons that you use in multiplayer and fit that into a sort of more prescribed campaign.
I think that first-person shooter, multiplayer, and single-player modes feel so much different to each other. You know, you're shooting, you know, in single-player in a FPS, you're shooting enemy soldiers. Like, Call of Duty is a totally different game. Like, you've got the same movement feel and the same guns, presumably, in the same settings, but you're playing in a completely different game across multiplayer and single player. Whereas in RTS, you're ostensibly playing the same game. And I think that's like where a lot of those tensions exist. And a lot, like you said, like a lot of the challenge comes in kind of making them both feel independently. Or make them in the first place, and then also making them feel independently kind of viable and worth it.
Yeah, I guess it's tricky as well, because if you have a single player thing, like you can't really. I mean, I guess StarCraft does do this in kind of some way, but it's very difficult to disconnect. Maybe easier in a shooter to disconnect what you have in the single player game from the multiplayer game. So you can't give someone a gun in the multiplayer or in the single player that then functions significantly differently, either more powerful, less powerful, whatever, in the multiplayer without feeling kind of. Without having to feel slightly shortchanged. I mean, I guess on the tail end, obviously the damage it does. I mean, Call of Duty does this, obviously, where playing it on harder difficulties, enemies take more bullets to take down than they actually do using the same gun in multiplayer. But then you do kind of need to give players the same for training purposes, but also just for the satisfaction purposes as well. So if they end up in a situation where they feel like the thing that they did enjoy in one of the modes doesn't feel the same in the other mode, it feels horrible.
Yeah, I've had a similar kind of experience with one of the games I wanted to talk about this week, which sort of seems kind of like, because it's been my main problem with the genre in general, but like a personal problem with it. This game called KARDS with a K, so K-A-R-D-S, and it's a collectible card game, sort of Hearthstone or Magic alike, but themed around the Second World War, which is kind of which is a really strange setting. It's quite a lot, like there's lots of sort of slightly odd things about it, but the hump that I get with these games is I can play the tutorials modes, and almost all of these games have some kind of single player way of playing, whether you're up against AI or there's like these sort of weird little campaign sort of modes in them as well. But the jump from going from playing against AI to playing against real people is just, for me, it's like a chasm I have no chance of getting across. Like, you know, because you're kind of going up against people all of a sudden who have decks that they've thought about and considered, and they understand the cards and their relationships, and you go in there and you just feel an absolute idiot. And it just, for me personally, just feels utterly hopeless. And I'm not a particularly competitive person. Like, I don't want to win so much as just have a nice time. I don't have a nice time at all. And like KARDS, I'm at that point where to continue to get out anything out of the game, I have to start playing against real people. And the one game I did play against a real person, I got completely trounced. And they were nice as well. They were kind of sending the little auto messages, you know. I don't know what language they were in, but you know how you've got, like in Hearthstone, you can click these predetermined messages, which are presumably translated for whatever language you're playing in. And they've been really nice. You know, they said that they made a mistake, except for I'm pretty sure that wasn't a mistake at all. And I did make a mistake, and it really was a mistake. And then they killed me. And but yeah, like KARDS, I wanted to talk about it because KARDS is also it's really interesting theming where, you know, normally with collectible card games, they're just resolutely fantasy based, and you're playing KARDS that become monsters, and you know, there's a sort of sense of total unrealness to it all that that makes the abstractions of KARDS work in some ways. But this one, when you play a KARD, like there'll be battalions, like named battalions in armies, and you're going to be playing factions, and the factions are the Soviets and the Americans and the British and the Germans. And it initially feels slightly odd in the same way that, in the same way that it feels odd to play a first-person shooter based on the Second World War these days, because, you know, should you be having fun? You know, these are real battles, and the extra abstraction that you get from playing a card game based on them is also a bit odd. And it also, but at the same time, it's theming itself on, you know, sort of cigarette card style, you know, comic book style kind of. So a lot of the pictures, I'm pretty sure, were sourced from you know, Pulp Fiction and cigarette cards, you know, of the, I guess, 50s, 60s, 70s. I don't know. Like, yeah, you know, so
that sounds cool.
And they look great. You know, it's like Jeeps kind of jumping over stuff with kind of below, you know, with the explosion behind, and you know, it's kind of exciting, you know, and interesting and you know, like really technicolor war, which kind of, but at the same time you're playing in a 3D kind of arena setting with kind of like a Luger, like a photorealistic Luger there, and when you click around KARDS you get a little history lesson, and there's kind of, you know, Call of Duty style sort of triumphant and yet somewhat mournful music playing as well. So I don't know what I'm meant to be feeling. I don't know what I'm meant to be. Is war good or bad? You know, that's all I need to know. Am I meant to be enjoying this or not? And it's a card game. And initially, like, it feels like it feels very like, oh, here we go. Like each card, unit card is exactly like Hearthstone, where it has an attack value and a defense value, and when they get hit they lose health by the amount of attack that they got hit by and all that kind of thing. But actually 5 minutes later it was really already demonstrating some like mechanics I've never seen before in these kinds of games. And in this one there are two things that really mark it out. The first is that your mana, which is named something weird in this one, I can't remember what it's called now. Anyway, mana, which is, you know, the currency that you get per turn to in order to play KARDS normally. So each KARD costs a certain mana to be able to play it. But also in this one, you need to spend mana on doing stuff with the KARDS you've already played. So if you've put a tank down, you've got two actions you can do with it at any time. You can either attack with it or you can move with it. I'll explain move in a sec. But those will cost you, in almost all cases, mana. So you're playing off, do you want to put more stuff down on the table, or do you want to save that mana to actually use the stuff you've already got down on the table? So that's like interesting decisions, you know, right from the off. And the other distinct thing that it does is that rather than having your set of KARDS on the table against the opponent's set of the KARDS on the table, it has a front line. And so if the front line, which is in between the two sides of KARDS, if it's unoccupied, you can move your KARDS into that front line. And for as long as you hold it with your KARDS, the other player is only able to attack those KARDS in the front line, unless they've got planes or artillery which can fire further. It's sort of like it all makes very intuitive sense, and it means you get this real push and pull as you move on and off the front line. The fact that your mana is being stretched over attacking, moving, and playing KARDS means that the battle is much longer than a normal Hearthstone or Magic match. It's and they feel attritional in an interesting way. Like you don't get these. I haven't had you know, I'm sure it's quite possible, but I haven't had these sort of games against the AI or whatever, where, you know, sort of a strategy is played and it's all over. In this one, you know, things kind of wobble and teeter, and I think that I got the advantage, and then I have to fall back and then regroup, and it feels really interesting.
The way you're describing it there, I mean, just the verbs you're using makes it sound like it is actually quite a good metaphor for the kinds of conflicts.
Exactly. Yeah.
Is it less gamey than, say, other card games in its effort to kind of make that metaphor more complete?
I mean, that's a good question, because it's like, I mean, it's sort of, when you play, it's a totally abstract card game with cigarette card art on it, you know, with when you're playing with numbers and rules. So no, but the effect of those rules is that you feel you're in a battle, like you feels like you're falling back, and it feels like it really does capture the theme, but totally abstractly. Like, you know, there aren't any rules. You know, sure, artillery can fire from your kind of your auxiliary line to your opponent's auxiliary line, but it doesn't feel like it's sort of that's a sort of a grab at a theme. It's just an abstract rule which just makes sense because of the theme, if that makes sense, that distinction.
Yeah, yeah.
And I really admire that. That is, like, you know, cool game design where abstract stuff coalesces into something that feels really naturalistic. And it's really, it's fun.
Does it have that kind of, like, the CCG, the Hearthstone kind of thing, where you do have these, you know, weird abilities? Like, you know, can you play Rommel like a Murloc kind of thing, where he does something amazing to all of your characters and they do loads more damage than they would do normally? Or is it kept quite straight and that, you know?
No, it's not. Like, I haven't played that much yet, but the factions are quite distinct from each other. So, the Soviets are very much about having cheap to play infantry, the cheap to play infantry, which, if they're powerful, they'll do damage to your HQ. Your HQ is the thing you're kind of defending. You know, when your HQ gets down to zero, then you lose, it's game over. So like, that's thematically sort of, you know, meaningful, because the Soviets were all about huge numbers of soldiers who are pummeled into war against, you know, and, you know, who all died, you know. That feels like it's expressing the Soviet sort of story. The American side is about raising mana. So, like, they seem to have quite a few cards which increase your mana for the next turn and that kind of thing, or just increase it turn upon turn upon turn. But everything's quite expensive. I haven't really got a feeling for what the British one has yet, but, you know, they do have distinct rules that support their theming, but they're all very recognizable CCG constructs, getting more mana, cheap to play but potentially damaging cards, you know, those sorts of things. It's a smart game, but I'm, you know, as I said at the start of this, I am at the stage where I've got to start making my own decks, and it's a free-to-play game, and it hasn't quite got the polish and allure and the kind of the self-confidence in itself that you see in things like Magic the Gathering Arena or Hearthstone, where they just give you loads of free stuff and they're kind of quite clear about, you know, how you get new stuff and things. This is much smaller project, and while there are loads and loads of cards and things, it doesn't have that sort of glossy, oh, I know exactly what I am with getting free packs and it's going to give me lots of free packs and I can get them. You do get free packs, but I'm not really sure how that all works yet. And buying sets, you know, buying sort of sets is kind of massively expensive. So I haven't really dipped into that. So I'm not really able to compete on any level. But there is, I was just going to also mention there's a campaign mode, so a single player kind of game. And there's only one free mission that I've been able to play. And this is another example of the theming working really well, where it's set, it's like the story, it's a set of a campaign set in North Africa, and it's the mission you play, or the battle you play, starts off with your Axis forces. So you're the Italians and the and Germans, and up against the British and also the French. And it starts off, and this is apparently historically correct scenario, there is this dug-in group of French forces who historically played a really important role in slowing down the advance, enemy advance. And they are there in the front line at the start of the game. And they're really annoying because they've got a high defense, not very high attack, but a high defense. Before you can do anything at all, you need to get rid of them. You know, and it's just it's a really simple piece of theming which expresses the historical context. It's cool.
Does that, I guess that's the question that kind of ties back into the RTS discussion as well, but is that, I'm trying to think of any game like along these lines from, you know, the RTS to the MOBA to the CCGs kind of things where they have a proper training space for you that you will actually learn about how, not just how the game works, like not just what do buttons do and what do I do to make win happen, but like here's the kind of decks you're going to face, here's the kind of players you're likely to face, here's how
this is the current meta.
yeah
I guess, like that definitely isn't here.
You always have to do that leap. I mean, I've tried to do it a few times in a number of games, like where you have to bite the bullet, decide, you almost have to make the decision ahead of time that I'm gonna play this, or I'm gonna try and get if not good but competent at this, therefore I'm now going to open 7 or 8 wiki tabs, hop on YouTube, sit through something I don't understand for the first 20-30 minutes of it, and then finally try and play along with this to try and get it. But you need to, it's difficult because you need to almost make that decision to play something before you've played it properly.
This is going to be my project. But then, you know, I don't know whether you can do that in game or whether you should do that in game, because I mean, first off, like practically, in order for a game to be good of this type, you need a shifting meta. So you don't want to teach anybody an established way of playing, because that should just shift and change, you know. And even if you do teach a simplified version of that, you have to go update all of your tutorials if you change the cards, you know, maybe something imbalanced, you know, which changes a load of builds or, you know, viable decks, or maybe, you know, you've had to take out that card entirely and now, you know, suddenly all your tutorials don't mean anything. But then, you know, should you teach anybody that? Like, there's a sort of a problem if you're making it too accessible, because if it's a good game, it has depth, and there's still going to be like a big yawning chasm, you know, between the skill of somebody who's just gone through the tutorial or is a newcomer and someone who's been playing and applying themselves for weeks and weeks. And there should be, you know, they should feel that the game reflects their greater skill, you know. It's an insurmountable problem, is what I'm saying.
Yeah, you've also got the fact that I guess any effort spent on tutorialization after you have a player base, which is the point when you can kind of go back and would have to, if you were going to update per meta, you'd have to update tutorialization based on that.
Exactly.
Your player base then is at the point where they're like, well, hang on, give us, we've got the basics, shut up. We want more cards, we want more stuff. Yeah. Don't waste your effort teaching newbies how to play.
Yeah, because they're all going to have that deck. It's like, you've got the starter deck, and everyone knows how to deal with the starter deck. The starter deck is quite perfectly good, but the problem is the rest of the player base knows exactly its strengths and weaknesses and just blasts it out of the water.
So maybe the question then is how you stand out in a crowded thing in order to get, because it's almost like you just need to kind of wait for a player base before, if you can't do the tutorialization to make the onboarding process smooth, you have to, I guess the ones that have hit successfully, you know, the Hearthstones of the world, the Magics of the world kind of had a big head start or a lot of money behind them. Because it's tricky to find examples of it. Maybe aesthetics. There's a lot potentially in this thing. It's interesting because they get things like Netrunner did well with a fairly small, like a starter base in kind of the real world, obviously, rather than the computer world. But that, I guess, does have its own history in an existing property as well, and is cool, looks cool because it's all cyberpunky and stuff. and does already have the engine behind it. I'm just wondering whether it's, you know, as a new studio, or at least a smaller studio, whether it is viable these days to do, you know, that kind of crossover free-to-play-esque
thing. Definitely. Well, I think also, like, with something like KARDS, you know, its player base is going to be way smaller. So, I mean, one of the answers to, you know, making that jump from, you know, into playing against other people is to do it, you know, on rankings. But the thing is, you need a big player base for you to find people of similar rank reliably, you know. So, and if your player doesn't, you know, you get the chicken and egg problem, you know. Your game isn't good enough or big enough to provide good games to people, so they don't play it, so the player base doesn't grow, you know.
Yeah. The answer is kind of, in order to be successful, you have to be successful.
Exactly. But I think another side of it is, you know, if you can make your game show what's happening in a really sort of succinct, clear, you know, sort of aesthetically pleasing way, that's good. I think that KARDS definitely suffers a little bit from some of that detailing where, oh, why did that one lose health? And you kind of, oh, you know, you've got to chase back through all the logic of the KARDS that were played and, you know, what happened. I think that something like Hearthstone is probably, there are all these little animations, auxiliary bits and pieces going on, showing you what happened as a result of a particular play. And I think that making all that stuff really legible really helps.
It's not a great name.
No.
KARDS.
No.
Doesn't really speak to its theme, does it?
No. It's got K on it, so it's like German, isn't it?
Oh, yeah.
So, and Germany's only to do with the war, so that's an obvious obvious relationship. Martin, what have you played?
I've been playing Mortal Shell. Which is a very much a Souls-like game, in that it's its own advertising. It advertises itself as a sort of Souls homage to Souls. It's in open beta at the moment on the Epic Game Store, so anybody can play it.
Wow!
I watched the video after you talked about it today, and I was like, I can't think of very many things on this planet that are more up my street than that.
Yeah, I mean, it is. It knows what it is and what it wants to be and who it needs to appeal to. I think all of its presentation so far has been. I mean, even if you think there's maybe some cynicism to making something which is so in hoc to an existing world or property, I mean, it's done extremely well. and I quite like what I've played, with some reservation. I have to say it's hard to judge what it will become based on the content of the demo, and I wonder if the further it gets through development, the more obvious it will diverge from the promise of the Souls games, just because the team is incredibly small and what they can achieve is presumably more limited. But what it currently is a tutorial, followed by two remarkably small but very dense environments, a sort of mucky-looking forest glen inhabited by also mucky-looking, incredibly sour, gangly bandits.
Gangly bandits.
Gangly bandits. And followed by the most ghastly, claustrophobic crypt, where there's these unpleasant vampiric ghouls who wait to feast upon your neck, and is patrolled by these Clive Barkerish undead beings who are skewered with like a dozen swords, and when they see you, they laboriously kind of extract one of these swords from their torso and then lob it at you, and eventually they tear off their own heads, which turn into explosive poisonous projectiles in a sort of final act of grisly defiance. And like the monster design is absolutely fantastic, and they've definitely got superb character archetypes, and they really do evoke the best low/dark fantasy aspects of the Souls games in this sort of horrible medieval nightmare. And, you know, hacking through this the handful of assholes that it throws at you across the course of an evening will give you a taste of the game's combat system and its particular spin on the life-death cycle, which is so important to those games, you know, and the economy and progression, etc. It's all shorn of, like, the larger context at the moment, but what's there I enjoyed. You play as this mouthless, genitalless, sinewy, biped, naked thing, which is seemingly made out of plaster of Paris or something. And the game's key innovation is that as this creature, you have the ability to possess corpses, or at least specific corpses, the mortal shells of the title. And these aren't just like enemies that you slain and can jump into. These are named characters that you come across slumped against a rock face somewhere. And they represent characters with backstories, but also character classes, essentially, which each have their own strengths and weaknesses and extensive upgrade trees. And the beta, you encounter two of these things, one of which is your basic knight in armor fella with a big two-handed sword, and a sort of rogue character who turns into a puff of smoke when he dodges. And he can interestingly, they don't have the weapons aren't tied to the characters, so the rogue character can wield the other guy's sword, but it intentionally doesn't put a lot of stats in your face, so it's not clear to me if there's a particular penalty or advantage really in mixing up weapons and shells. But you also find this hammer and chisel next to the rogue's body, and that sort of suits his more fast, frenzied attack style, which is actually how I've played all of the Souls games so far. I never did the sword and board thing in Dark Souls. I always played Dark Souls like people are meant to play Bloodborne, basically. I always go for the kind of quick weapons and sort of max stamina, so I can basically roll continuously around enemies and then stab them in the bottom. That's my thing. And interestingly, this expresses a sort of dissatisfaction to some extent with the FromSoft games as they've progressed, culminating in Sekiro, which I like, but I think it's still my least favorite of those games, because they've become increasingly focused on asking people to parry and asking people to observe specific timing challenges. And the earlier games are not really about that, or at least they have a breadth to the way that you can play them that you don't really need to engage with that challenge at all. So I don't think I've parried really more than once or twice in any of those games cumulatively. But parrying is a big thing in, obviously it's a huge thing in Sekiro, and it's a big thing in this, but I'll get back to that. So anyway, the shells are a cool approach to character classes. And there's like you can switch between them at the beginning of any new area, or it's, well, at least in the demo. I don't know if that's just like a contrivance for the demo's purposes. But the other big thing to compare it with the sort of famed Soulsian mechanics is the way that death works in the game, which is more like Sekiro's than any of the other Souls games, which is that when you die, you're Mr. Jiminy No Genitals character sort of gets expelled from the shell you're in, get blasted out backwards. And you're like super vulnerable when you're in your naked form. And if you get like clobbered again once, you'll probably die. And then you have to start the area again, and all the enemies will have respawned.
Does the body that you play in kind of just lie on the ground like a discarded plastic bag?
Sort of. And it actually kind of freezes in its struck pose. While you're sort of out of your body, you can, time sort of gets paused for a moment after you get hit, which is really cool because having been punted out of your shell, you then have this like second or two to reposition and maybe get behind the enemy who nobbled you in the first place, which is like this sort of neat thing. And then but you can also re-enter your shell, simply by pressing A on it. I'm not, you might want to do that after you've, you know, removed the immediate threat, but you, once you've entered your shell, you get your full health back straight away. But there isn't a second chance then. If you get killed a second time, it's, you know, level start. But it's just this sort of it's basically a second chance at getting through a single level, which makes it quite difficult to sort of parse how like health management works, because you need, even though you're you take a hit from any enemy, it's really bad news in this game. But you also need to factor that against, you know, when you're making those kind of risk reward calculations that all these games make you do, you also have to factor in the fact that you have another 100% of health hidden away behind your current state. But in other regards, like the, I mean, it's a bit more punishing. There's no, there are healing items found in the levels, like mushrooms, and interestingly, they respawn over a period of time, even on a single run. But there's no Estus equivalent.
So there's no health gathering at all.
There's mushrooms which replenish health over time. You can buy food and things, but you don't have, so Estus in the Souls games, to explain for people who never played them, is like a flask that you have with you at all times, which contains a number of healing drafts, and that refills magically basically every time you restart a section of the game. And that is not here, so you don't have anything like that, and which would make the game a lot more challenging were it not for the fact that healing is tied into combat in a sort of Bloodborne / Sekiro mashup. Your parry system is the main way in which you replenish health. So deflecting a blow and then getting a riposte heals you an incredibly large amount. And it's, although I got away with being pretty shit throughout the demo, it's clearly going to be a pretty essential thing for you to learn to do. And as with all these games, I find that the parry window just not particularly clearly defined. I had a little trouble working out when I'm meant to be parrying, whether it's at the point of collision or before. It's not clear from the attack animations when or your parry animation when you're meant to be pressing it. But I had better success with the game's other pseudo parry, which is that you can harden at any point. Essentially, at the press of a button, you become, you're like the plaster of Paris suddenly freezes, and you become this sort of statue, and you deflect any attack which lands on you in that state, which sounds like OP, but it's got a cool cooldown, so you can't just spam it, and it only works to deflect in a single attack, so it won't save you from combos. But it's a really cool idea, and you can like consume items which then enhance your next strike at least some of the damage that you would have absorbed when you were hit in your hardened form. And you can also harden at any point and maintain your momentum. So you can sort of wind up this heavy attack, suck up a blow in your hardened form from the enemy, and then immediately follow through with your strike. And it feels really cool. I don't know that it's interesting enough to hang an entire combat system off it, but it's okay. It's okay.
The kind of hanging a lot, you can go through that kind of tick all the boxes as you called out, like the one and resurrection is obviously with Sekiro, and then you've got the Bloodborne getting health back stuff as well. I mean, it's all good for me because these are all my favorite things in the world. Like, it's interesting as well, the parry stuff, because I think I played Dark Souls a lot, and I always played it very, very not Sekiro-y, as you did as well. Like, but I played it even more, like, I always played a bowman. I always had a bow, and I would absolutely just game the system. Like, if you're a big man and you can't get through that small door, I'm going to stand on the side of the small door and I'm going to keep shooting you for the next hour and a half until I win. And that was, you know, I remember interviews in Miyazaki, and he was just like, yeah, well, if you want to play like that, that's why we set it up like that. And it's why they refused to patch things like the door in the forest that led to the people who would, you know, jump off the edge and give you souls. Because they're like, well, you're using the game against the game. The game's using itself against you. That's kind of fine. We'll let you do that. Then Sekiro, I took a very long time to click with. I got it when it came out And then fairly soon afterwards, around my son had been born. So I didn't have much time and I felt bounced off it. I was like, oh, this is the first Souls game, the first From game on that kind of trajectory that I really don't like. Came back to it like earlier this year and was just absolutely enamored with it when I suddenly got the parry timing, suddenly clocked it. And then
it's very much an anti-cheese game, right?
Yeah. Well,
in comparison to Dark Souls.
Don't look at my playthrough, please. But yes, it is. there's a lot of bits in it that are difficult to cheese. And they're possible to cheese it. And, the cheeses in that they're very, I guess there's an argument between like a glitch in the cheese and Dark Souls. You know, when I remember spending hours and hours and hours early on, I reviewed Dark Souls back in the mists of time. I was playing it before it ever went online. And I was playing it solo with a few people in the offices in Future in Bath in the UK. And we were all desperately trying to muddle our way through. And then when one of us kind of realized that you could open this door and get through to the other side, and there was this very high, for us at the time, high level enemies that would drop a lot of souls, and you could farm them by standing behind a little staircase next to this giant ledge that led to nothing. And anyone that fell off that would die. If you stood at the right place on the staircase, they would take the path up the stairs rather than along the side of the staircase to get you, try to attack you, bounce off your head, get stun locked, and then fall to their deaths. So every 10 minutes or so, you could harvest about 10,000 souls, which was enough at the time to really start ranking you up in the game. But not only was it completely inexplicable to what was happening, but also there was no messages on the floor, no other players anywhere, no one leading you anywhere. And obviously, everyone who's played Dark Souls knows there's not really like the most. If you were to follow the natural signposting of the level, you go to one of the mid late stage games in the Tomb of the Giants. It's nightmarishly difficult and pitch black. So it's really the game kind of sticking two fingers up at you and laughing.
Yeah, I don't feel too bad about cheesing Dark Souls, because I mean, Dark Souls is at times trying to trick you into doing things which are too difficult for your character to even do. I don't know. I think for me though, like, I mean, obviously this game has like, there's a spooky masked lady, which is very, very in keeping with the general theme of these sort of games. And it's, she essentially acts as your bonfire. So you can restart the level by talking to her, and there's, there's an economy that you'd expect from these games. Tar seems to be the main currency. I don't know if that's going to turn into a metaphor for something. It's not yet clear what. And there's a man who'll sell you things in exchange for tar and lets you pet his fucking weird looking cat. And there's other stuff which allow you to upgrade your individual shells, and you can't upgrade to those things. And I mean, all of that stuff feels like it's sort of like checklist things that appear in Dark Souls. I find it most obvious when games take that stuff from Dark Souls that I don't really care about that stuff. Like, I mean, none of it's bad. Like, it all obviously needs to be there for the game to function. But the thing that's attractive to me about the Souls-like games is not really any of that stuff piecemeal.
Yeah,
it's like it's the sum of the parts that really makes those games. In isolation, the fact that you use bonfires or some other metaphor for a checkpointing system, or that, you know, when you die, you lose resources that can be recollected when you make it back to your corpse. Those things have become this sort of mechanical rote, such that they're almost collectively a genre.
Yeah.
But and those things are cool, but they don't have resonance for me when they're separated from the world of those games and all the other systems which they intertwine with, both like in fictional terms and as like the structural devices for the game's economy and advancement systems. And like, I don't know whether all that stuff is going to gel in Mortal Shell yet, because it's just shorn of the larger context. And I'm not just talking about lore, of which there is just a kind of threadbare amount in the demo, but and also the lore, it's about trust as well to some extent. I mean, whether the lore in propping up these systems feels just like it's there to excuse the mechanics, which are now so famous in and of themselves, or whether they are some actually kind of elegant. The thing about Dark Souls is that you can't really bottle that lightning again. that the kind of revelation that these game mechanics were actually in service to something which was a completely coherent fantasy universe in which the metaphysics of that universe was entwined in everything that you do. And I don't know that you can just click your fingers and do that again, at least not using the same mechanics.
Yeah, you could, particularly as those mechanics, and particularly as that metaphysics was actually a commentary on the way the game played as well, and to just take on the same mechanics is to actually to do something that the game, that the mechanics were originally criticizing.
Yeah, I mean, it's Dark Souls is, the whole thing is that this is a cycle that will happen again and again and again and again. Like, it's futility. It's a consideration on all, like, as well as being a super fun game, but it's like a, consideration on futility and the fact that you're stuck in the cycle and all these things that games.
So there you go. And people will use these mechanics over and over again. It was showed the futility of it, and we're all locked into a cycle.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's an interesting thing where I've had the same question where, like, I love Dark Souls. I love the series. I love Bloodborne. I love Sekiro as well. And it's just, I love Demon's Souls before it too. And I've played other games in the Souls-like, Souls-borne kind of genre, and I bounce off every single one pretty much because, it's really tricky to work out why necessarily. And I guess that's definitely some of it. It's such a nebulous term, but the idea of world building, it's not just like I've written the story Bible and here's every possible person in the Bible and here's every person, here's their interactions and here's their mum and here's their dad. It's not the Tolkien-esque approach of here's 70 family trees, X begat Y, begat Z, but like, it's the idea that the world is built rather than just talked about. Like, everything is, as you say, fully in service to everything else. Like, you can imagine a world where, you see these undead praying and crawling around everywhere, and that could be you if you give up on the game at this point and you move on. And, you see these corpses of things, and it's done with such a light touch. And it makes sense. But you see the designer's hand in so many different places. And the whole thing about him having thought up Firelink Shran and then, walked mentally to all the other places, and that's why the map, actually, apart from Anor Londo, kind of glues itself together perfectly. It's because this is a place rather than it's a world that was built rather than just kind of world building as a concept. And this other games, for various reasons, don't have that. And maybe because they're trying to chase an existing genre rather than kind of doing it naturally, or maybe because they just haven't got the time or the eye or whatever. They don't have that. But like, I was realizing this recently, like thinking about my favorite things to think about Warhammer. Like, I love 40K, and then I love, by extension, I like playing war game, the 40K war game, and I love that whole sphere. And then friends are like, oh, we should play other war games. I'm like, I have zero interest.
No.
I just realized it's not the system necessarily that I'm into. Thing that I'm into. It's the world.
Yeah, I don't think I'm a man child, but I definitely only want to play a war game on a table which involves my little gribbly friends, space marines, cyber monks. That's all I want. If you made it Second World War, I'm happy to play Second World War themed things on my computer, but not on the tabletop.
Yeah, even like, if someone else is super up for playing, I'll play with you and stuff. But it's like, it's not this kind of all-encompassing thing that Dark Souls became for me, where I would, go onto YouTube and start looking up lore videos, and I would be trying to work out, why is this corpse specifically died here, and read the item descriptions. All this stuff is done with such a, it's either done with a very, if you look at it through my lens, it's done with such a beautiful light touch, or there's fuck all story, as a lot of people will say, and it's all just wanky bullshit. Like, some people will definitely argue that in that case, and it's just an excuse to have a Western fantasy world through a Japanese lens that hangs together very well. But I think that's also great about Dark Souls, is that you can play it as either, and it works as a very well structured combat game, not as tight as something like Sekiro later, but the combat works on it by itself. But then you've also got this huge depth and huge kind of internalized history. Not just in the actual written history, but just in the way that the world hangs together as well.
I think it's that. I mean, I think it's very physical as well. The success of those games is literally in the way those environments are built and intertwine because there's just a rationality. I mean, it might be a mad fantasy world rationality, but there is a rationality to where things are, and that just at an unconscious level maybe just makes you feel more rooted in that world.
Is there the same sense in Mortal Coil?
No.
Obviously it's a small area, so you're not going to get that much of a thing, but...
Well, I mean, this is the problem. So I don't know. I mean, it's hard to say how much of this is just because maybe these are environments that have just been plucked from a larger world and then tied together in an awkward way for the purposes of testing them with the public. But they are very small environments to the extent that they feel like they are small because they are worried about loading times. And they are separated by loading screens. They are not interconnected in the way in the seamless way that the Souls worlds are. And there aren't like vistas. You can't see out of the environments that you're in. Environments.
If I was making this game, I think that would be up there among the things that I'd be worried about, that I would want people to know that this world was cohesive and that you could look out over it. I would ensure that the demo would include something like that.
Yeah.
Really, I guess you've got kind of the extreme of, you know, if you're really super ultra confident in your combat system, you could go the like Devil May Cry route and just have your fairly small built arena kind of things.
But that's an arena game. That's an arena game. It's not an adventure.
Yeah. I don't know. And also, I don't really know how. I mean, obviously, this is being beta tested in order to continue to balance the game. But it's either incredibly well thought out or not well thought out at all. The two most useless conclusions one can draw from it. Because Dark Souls, part of the difficulty of that game is thematic, right? It is about this repetition and eventually giving up, as you were talking about, Rich. You know, you could be any one of the corpses along the way because you've gone hollow, you've given up. And so that is part of the reason why it's such a challenging and at times dismaying experience, because it's engineered to induce dismay and to make you want to give up. And so I'm not like really into inverted commas difficult games in other contexts, but it could be that Mortal Shell has something interesting to say about difficulty, or at least it structures its challenge in an interesting way, in that it is initially very difficult, at least when you're getting to grips with the your parry and your hardening skills, and enemies of all types are incredibly lethal, and yet you only sort of need to get like one upgrade maybe or one sort of like, even just like a realization of how you use the hammer and chisel, and actually the enemy's health bars are such that you can wail on them and they won't be able to land a single blow before they're dead in the second area. And suddenly it flips from being this incredibly challenging experience where you're edging around corners and trying to kite enemies one at a time, to being not quite trivial, because still if you fluff it and take damage, it's still a bad news. But it's almost like an accelerated version of that Dark Souls leveling curve where things are really arduous to begin with, and then 6 hours later you come back to the same arena and it's a pushover. And that seems to happen across the course of maybe an hour in these environments, where you realize the one thing that you need to do in order to make enemies a pushover, and suddenly it's not a challenge at all. To the extent that like you can grind a tiny bit in the second area, and you can get an upgrade for one of your characters which converts poison damage, which is one of the enemies in the area's principal damage types, into health. So like the difficulty just flips almost instantaneously when you get to that. And I don't know if that's intentional or whether that's just a balancing mistake. I have to say, I don't mind it though. Like going from something which is really hard and then having a revelation and then it becoming trivial doesn't feel bad to me, actually. But it also may be evidence that the game as a whole isn't that well considered. I just don't know.
I think that's the thing about the thing that I realized with Sekiro. Like, the Dark Souls does it really well. Like, it, you have a sense of, as you say, exactly, like, you have a sense of mastery over it. Where you, it's not, in a certain way, it is because of your stats. You've just got more health and you hit harder than you used to. But when you come back to a previous area, it's now, as you say, trivial. And, oh my God, how did I have trouble with this kind of thing? But then how much of that is you just being good at it now? Like, that kind of mental leveling that is entirely on you. And that is, when that is done well, that feels fantastic. And that's what Sekiro did to me. It was that, like, I just can't get this. I just can't get this, the parrying right. I just feel, I keep dodging. I keep getting hit. I don't understand this. And then you get that moment, or I got that moment anyway, where suddenly it just kind of opened up and I could feel it just kind of opening up. And it was less of a sense of, okay, I've now got enough health, I can do this boss. It's not just like, I'm just going to get wailed on all the way through. And it's not like, now I hit hard enough that I actually can kill these things fast enough. It was something I unlocked in my hands and in my brain. And that being able to do that is a really difficult line to walk. I think I can't think of many games that kind of do manage that properly. So yeah, it's interesting to see whether Mortshell does do it through, you know, that light touch and that way of saying, okay, well, this will click with you when it clicks with you, or whether it's them being like, now poison damage is health, you will be better at game.
Well, exactly. At this point, I think it's getting better. I mean, the difference in difficulty was like maybe 70%, maybe 60% me getting just genuinely better and understanding how to fight these particular enemies, and 40% just getting a buff.
That's a good percentage.
And I don't think that's necessarily bad. And I think because the environments are so small, you wouldn't want to spend much more time in them, going over and over and over them again. That said, there are enemies who like, there's instances where, you know, these enemies will do this big wind-up attack, and then they just won't close the distance between them and you, and they will just miss. Which is actually kind of annoying, because you actually need them to try and hit you in order to parry them, in order to regain health. But I'm guessing that kind of stuff is... the reason I mention that is that seems to be like, oh, that's clear and cut evidence that there is balancing yet to be done. There are clear errors, you know, in the design. But I think that kind of stuff is easier to tighten up. And I have good feelings about where this will go. I think the claims being made for it... will probably lead people into false expectations of its grandeur, because it is such a small studio, and the size of the environments suggests to me that they will continue to scope down. But, you know, within that scope, I think, you know, it remains to be seen whether like a part reproduction of the Soulsian promise is enough.
It does seem like the art and the kind of the presentation of it is going very, you know, it's got that kind of very Dark Souls-y. I mean, obviously it looks very Dark Souls-y, but the story being is as epic and sweeping as it seems to look, with these giant cast of characters, like giant cast of giant characters, demons and monsters, and these kind of, the art reminded me of the Polish artist who I always forget his name, who does this kind of World War II and later kind of horrible, almost Geiger-esque illustrations on humanity, and these kind of skulls made out of writhing human bodies and these post-apocalyptic. Oh,
okay. Yeah, oh, you did Alien.
No, but there's another, the Polish, so Geiger obviously did that one, but yeah, there's a Polish artist who, I can't remember his name, I guess I put it in the show notes, but he did these amazing post-apocalyptic, but kind of post, like, human things as well, that were like, look like buildings made out of like bones and people, and he was raised during World War II, and you kind of seen the horror of the Eastern Front as well, so it was all kind of based on that, and that kind of face, I think this eyeless, noseless kind of thing is very,
I think we've talked about him on the podcast before actually, is it I have no idea how to pronounce the name, unfortunately.
Yeah, it's beginning with
Beksinski,
yes,
and his first name is Zdzilav. I'm sorry, Polish people.
Yes,
Zdzilav.
Very sorry, Polish people. It is a lot. It's a lot of name, but his art is very. I mean, I love it. It's my kind of, like, you know, black metal album cover kind of aesthetic, and it goes into that kind of thing, and it leans into that. At least Mortal Shell, the stuff I saw, leans into that in the Dark Souls, in like huge, epic, sweeping story about history and time and demons and legends and stuff, but then also this kind of nice art. Does it maintain that through the game as well, or is it a bit more parochial in that term?
Oh, I don't know. I mean, the two areas I've seen are certainly all very in keeping with that. Who knows whether they'll sustain it throughout the entire thing?
Yeah, not having the vistas is kind of Sekiro being a tighter combat game still has its moments where you just go, oh wow, I can go over there. Oh god, I can go over there. Like, I don't want to. Mm. It's too big.
Yeah, it's very much about exploring those games and the promise of a larger world. Whereas sort of more confined static spaces, I don't know. I don't know if that'll sing in the same way. But I'm willing to give it a go.
Yeah, I'm excited. You've excited me.
Jolly good. That was my aim. Shall we do some questions from questions?
Yes, please.
Yeah.
We only have one question this week. So it needs to be a good one. And it is. It's from Kane. He says, hello. The developers of Deep Rock Galactic added the ability to pet loot bugs and also made them wiggle around and purr when you pet them. This has divided the player base between those who won't kill anything they can pet and amoral monsters, the subject of an ongoing international criminal court referral. Comics and memes about the situation abound. What's your position on murdering versus petting loot bugs? Personally, I've decided to only kill the golden ones and reframe my greed as a kind of anti-capitalist class war, aiding the loot bug proletariat in their struggle against their gold-plated bourgeois oppressors. As a follow-up, what other things in video games should be pettable? Regards, Kane.
Gosh, I actually played Deep Rock Galactic just the night before last, and I shot up a loot bug not knowing that I could pet it. I think my feeling is that I'm going to go at it from the role-playing position, which is you are avaristic, horrifically capitalistic characters who are destroying a planet for their own gain. And therefore, I would definitely pat and then kill all of the loot bugs.
Are you really doing it for your own gain, or is it for the gain of the corporation with whom you're in?
I think you're contracting for a corporation, but like I'm complicit, right? I'm totally complicit.
I'm basically asking the question of capitalism there, Martin, as well.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, are you really complicit in the capitalist machine which grinds you down?
Well, I would go on my spaceship and I'd find a nice garden world and I'd settle down there.
Yeah.
What do you do on the hub area, on your spaceship? You drink beer. That's just hedonistic. You buy clothes, also hedonistic. There's no sense of your character being pleasant or anything other than self-driven scum. So I would pet to get the pleasure out of petting and then murder the loot bugs.
Oh my god, you would do both?
Of course. You get both. Why not? Get it all. Take it all. That's what the game's about.
Take it out back, pat it in the head, shoot it in the back of the head.
And the creatures that are coming after you are they're the planet trying to fight back against your wicked incursions. They are the goodies. And I'm killing them. They're probably defending the loot bugs. So yep. So I would say, I'd say, role play it.
Rich, do you have a position on this? I don't know if you've played Deep Rock Galactic.
I haven't, no, but I have a very strong position on anything that is that kind of family of small, potentially pettable, cute thing, and that is completely pro them. Like I have massive problems with this in games. Like I remember. Isn't the bit in Deus Ex when you meet the woman who talks about the greasy, greasy greasels and there's loads of rats around there?
Oh, yeah.
And when she talks about them, I was walking past and then I didn't jump, but I walked off a step and landed on a rat. And then I went, ee! And I had to reload the game and I did the same thing again. And I landed on a cat this time and it went, meh, and died. So both times I was like, well, I can't continue this playthrough knowing what I've done. So I have to reload. And I carried that through pretty much my entire gameplay history to the point whenever I play Red Dead and I find anyone hunting, I always lasso them and drag them behind me until they're dead.
So that's what happened to me, because I was hunting in Red Dead Redemption and then someone lassoed me in real life, dragged me behind their horse and left me for dead.
Yeah, sorry. Nice to see you again.
Do you kill greasels, though, having been humanized by that nursery rhyme?
The greasels, actually, I think every time I play those, I always let them out to so they can kill everyone else and get their own back. And, you know, it's that kind of typically amoral, well, not amoral, but kind of like centrist approach that's just like, well, I didn't kill them. They killed themselves. They got killed in a fight with someone else. I'm all right. My ethics are clear. I'm fine. But yeah, no, I have massive trouble with any kind of anything that is, I'm so wildly sentimental that anything that is vaguely, like, not anthropomorphized, but like petapomorph, well, there must be a word for that, that's like turned into something cute or even vaguely like connectionable. I'm just like, well, I've got to protect you with my life now.
Oh,
yeah.
Couple of hippies, you two.
Yeah.
Yeah, I've made peace with the fact that I need to kill dogs in Desperados, which I normally hate killing animals in video games because they're, you know, innocent by comparison to their obviously also completely non-sentient human NPC characters. But it's okay in Desperados because the dog models are so awful. They don't even register to me as a dog.
I'm worried about your morality here, because what you're saying is that you have your own sliding scale of whether an animal is allowed to live or not, and it's basically on its aesthetics.
Yeah, how ugly is it? Should it die?
Well, it's not so much that it's an ugly model. I'm not making a qualitative judgment on it. I'm saying it just doesn't read to me as an animal or a dog.
So if you came across a horrifically sort of messed up dog, it's congenital problems, all kinds of awful physical malformed things are going on with it, You'd be fine with just bludgeoning it because it doesn't look nice.
Well, it's like that in Alien Resurrection. It's just, you know, kill me.
Yeah, maybe that's, yeah. Maybe that's, he's gone, but yeah.
I'm such a bad dog, I need to die.
Are there any things that are not pettable in games that should be?
I got guns. Guns? No, they are, though. You're always showing them off and kind of... So all sorts of petting going on in
it should be. It happens a lot in VR. Whenever I play VR something, I always find myself stroking a lot more things than you do kind of in real life. But like you can, you know, stroke radios and Alex and just like various surfaces. The wonder of
But touch. That's just an affordance though. I think that like that this game, the game designers haven't said, oh, we should let you do this. You are just allowed to do it. I think I was thinking I would really like to be able to pet concrete buildings because I don't think... Have you ever stroked a concrete building?
Yes. I think I've touched concrete before.
Have you tried to kind of absorb its materiality before? Have you been it's down concrete. The South Bank in London and just seen a nice bit of beautiful bit of formwork and just run your hand over it? Because you should.
No.
You really should.
Now, I know you're a big fan of the carbuncle, aren't you, Alex?
I love the carbuncle. And
the carbuncle.
Control should allow you to be able to pet the carbuncle.
It's like in Star Wars, a force pet. You can just do it from distance with your hand out.
Yeah, force pet. And then like your controller could rumble, you know, giving you the sense of its texture.
Oh, yeah.
Ooh. That'd be lovely, wouldn't it?
Yeah, what's that concrete that's been set against planks of wood and has been
formwork?
Oh, that is formwork, yeah. Is it? Oh, yeah. Yeah, there you go.
Yeah,
I mean, there's definitely like the Twitter account obviously has a lot to answer for in terms of everything having to have something pettable now in it. So I guess we're not a million miles away from that point. Maybe in games like Cards, you should be able to pet the cards, give them a lovely stroke.
Yes,
pet Rommel. No, you don't want to pet Rommel.
Have you? What would you like to pet? You're conspicuous by your silence here.
Marcus Phoenix, I think. obviously, it would need there would need to be consent involved. I'd like to pet Marcus Phoenix, and I imagine that he would roll over on his back and rub his belly, and he would.
His little leg would waddle around.
Yeah. Maybe he'd get a little bit excited and wet himself.
Growling
like
away.
Jim does.
That'd be lovely, wouldn't it?
Yeah. Well, I'm glad we've cleared that up. Yeah. Really, that was one of the overhanging questions that has remained.
I don't know how it hasn't come up before.
Yeah. So that was the one question we got this week. If you'd like to send us another question, you can do so at questions@cratencrowbar.com. You can tweet us @cratencrowbar. All these recordings are uploaded as videos to YouTube, where you can find other bullshit by us. The address for that is youtube.com/cratencrowbar. And thank you to our Patreon backers. You can back us as well, if you like, at patreon.com/cratencrowbar. Or you can join our lovely Discord community, who are wonderful and are a nourishing presence in this otherwise hostile world. You can find the link to our Discord on our website, which is, very sensibly enough, cratencrowbar.com. I've been Marsh Davis.
I've been Alex Wiltshire.
I've been Rich McCormick.
Thanks for listening, everybody. Bye. Bye.